Praise God. I want to be at that meeting, don't you?
Amen.
Praise God. That's one meeting I don't want to be late for. I don't want a conference call it.
That's right.
I don't want to get the notes from it. I want to experience it.
Amen.
Amen. The young people are dismissed at Children's Church this morning. Turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Acts chapter number 15. Acts chapter number 15. Amen. Acts 15, we're going to start reading at verse number 14. The Bible says, Simon has, or if you need to refresh your memory, this is Simon Peter. Simon Peter has declared how God at first did visit the Gentiles to take out of them a people for his name. Amen. God has people. God has a plan. Amen. And to this agree the words of the prophet. As it is written, after this I will return and will build again the tabernacle of David. This is talking of things that is to come. Which is fallen down, and I will build again the ruins thereof, and I will set it up. That the residue of men might seek after the Lord, and all the Gentiles whom my name is called, saith the Lord, who doth all these things. I'm going to jump back to this in a minute, but let me just ask you a question. How many of you know that basically in life you get what you pay for?
Amen.
You do, you get what you pay for. And we're living in a very consumer-based world in which there's access to an unlimited amount of information and about products and the services and what they get. It is said that of 93% of consumers who's going to buy a product, they will go online and they will read the reviews. How many of you have done that yourself? You're looking for something and you're making comparisons. Boy, I know we have consumer reports, but if you're buying something on whatever site it may be on, Amazon to Walmart to whatever, you typically can go on and there will be reviews. And before I ever make my purchase on Amazon, one of the buttons I click is I want 4-star or higher. That means that they get a 4-star review. It's one of the highest reviews. And you begin to read those reviews, and it's said that out of customers who are purchasing, that over 60% of customers look at online reviews at least once a week. And out of those individuals, there are 21% that will review the reviews multiple times a week. So we are looking for something, and you know what we're looking for? Everybody likes to get a bargain, right?
Yeah.
Amen.
Okay, if not. Everybody likes a bargain.
Yeah.
But we get what we pay for.
Yeah.
And more often than not, it's better just to pay for what you're getting. Cheaper doesn't always mean better. You get what you pay for, even though you have a bargain. You know, you may get a contractor, but he may give you a lower bid, but he may not have a respectable reputation as others have, and you may not get the quality that you're looking for in buying cheaper. We made a deal with our girls yesterday. We had to go to a plumbing in front of their glasses. And so, in the middle of everything, we made a deal that if they were good with their playhouse, we would get them a Barbie. They only have one Barbie, and it was not really adequate. And so, Sister Tina, I made this deal. But I made it within budget, Brother Dennis, because I knew that we could probably find a Dollar Tree. Right? And so we were able to purchase a Barbie, Sister Jan, for $1, or at least a knockoff Barbie, right? For this $1. And so Brother Wally, we brought it home, and within 5 minutes of opening it, guess what? There was an arm off. And I can't tell you, Sister Alice, how many times I put arms and legs back on Barbies since yesterday. But I got what I paid for. I knew it. I knew it wasn't going to be the quality, but I knew it was what I wanted to spend, and it would satisfy the need. And so I need to tell you that when it comes to spiritual things, there is a price for the presence of God. There is a price for the presence of God. There can be that of cheaper versions and remedies, but there's a price that's paid for the real presence of God. I don't want to be left here alone this morning, but I want to talk to you about that very quickly. But I want to talk to you very adamantly and very really that there's a price for the presence of God. We find that here the Word of God says that God would rebuild the tabernacle. You look in the Word of God, you'll find that there is Moses' tabernacle, there is that of Solomon's temple. How extravagant, how wonderful, how great. But in the middle of it all, we are told here in the book of Acts that David's tabernacle is the favorite of God's houses, and God wants to rebuild that. And let me tell you that there's a reason why God wanted to rebuild it, because there were some good memories God had of that makeshift tabernacle that David built, because David was willing to pay the price for the presence of God. You see, I know that Solomon was willing to pay a price for the temple, and David already started things, but the temple in which Solomon had built, it was built with a price tag, and it was ornate, and it was beautiful, but it was not God's favorite, because the price tag was not paid for the presence of God that God desired to permeate the place of worship for His people. There is a price tag that goes with the presence of God. In fact, you'll find that David's was less structure, but you'll find that less structure, there was there was less structure, but there was more bit of God's presence. Oftentimes, we will find that there are greater structures in the church world, whether it's by that of what we come and look at an ornate and a beautiful sanctuary, or whether it's by an agenda or a program that is that they go by, but there is less of the presence of God. There's a price tag that is paid for the presence of God. God is not looking for us to impress Him, but God is looking for us to want His heart. And so, in Acts chapter 13, verse number 22, the Word of God says, and when He had removed, speaking of Saul, He raised up Saul, the first king of Israel. He raised up David to be their king, to whom also he gave testimony and said, I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after my own heart, which is full of all my will. You see, the people became anxious to get a king. And you know the story. Israel, they wanted a king, but they wanted it right here and right now, and they didn't seek out God and the plan and the ways of God. And they got what they wanted, but they didn't want what they got. Oftentimes we'll find that in our life, taking a cheaper route to things spiritually will not ever be advantageous to us in the long run. But when we are willing to pay the price for the presence of God and the endurance of things, we will be glad that we paid the price for the presence of God Almighty.
Amen.
Amen. The most powerful component of David's tabernacle was built long before the structure was ever built to house the Ark of the Covenant. You see, David had a desire for the presence of God and a heart for God.
Amen.
If we want God's presence, it starts with a heart that is after God and a desire to long for God. David said it this way, as the heart panteth after the water brooks, so panteth my soul after thee, O God. We've got to have a heart and a soul that longs for God Almighty more than anything else. Pay the price for the presence of God. You see, David was pursuing the presence of God even when he was chasing after sheep on the hill. He was already worshiping there on his harp. He was singing songs to God, and he was becoming a songwriter, and he was becoming a worshiper before anyone else knew him, and anyone the task of slaying lions and bears and worshiping God for the strength that he gave him for winning the victory.
Amen.
There's a price to the presence of God. He had a passion for God. David began to talk about bringing the Ark of the Covenant to Jerusalem. He wasn't interested in the ornate ark. He wasn't looking for the gold. He wasn't looking for the articles that was there in that Ark of the Covenant, though they are important for teaching. And God revealed himself in those three items. David wasn't worried about those articles. David wasn't worried about what the cherubims looked like. He was more concerned about the blue flame that dwelt between the wings of the cherubims, which was the presence of God. That is what he longed after more than anything else. God, I want the Shekinah glory of your presence. God, help us to have a heart that hungers for the presence of God more than anything else. You see, there was something about this ark that was so different than Moses' tabernacle and Solomon's temple. You'll find that the ark was open, that there was not a veil separating man from the ark. But you'll find that David brought the ark and man could see the ark. God never designed for there to be a veil between us and his presence. God always wanted his people to experience his presence, and God's heart is still for that, but there's a price that must be paid for us to experience the presence of God. Yes, Jesus has paid the price, but you and I have a price to pay as well. I'm not minimizing the blood. I'm not minimizing the work of the cross, but I'm saying that we must pay the price for the blood of Jesus Christ to be applied to our heart, and the price to live holy, to keep the presence of God. See, sinful humanity was always separated from the presence of God. But when Jesus died upon the ark, or upon the cross of Calvary, the veil was rent from top to bottom. God said, I want my presence to be with my people. And then God wants his presence to be with us. Amen. He never wants us to be separated, never a veil. The only thing that we find that was around this ark when David brought it, there was worship and there was praise and there was attention given to the ark 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. There is a price to be paid for the presence of God. If we want the presence of God, it's not just ours to pull out on Sunday morning. It's not just ours to pull out when things go wrong. There's a price to be paid every hour of the day, every day of the week, to worship in the presence of God. There's a price tag. Are you willing to pay the price for the presence of God Almighty?
Amen.
Praise God. Amen. There was a humbleness about the tent. There was simplicity that was around the presence of God. Amen. You'll find that when David began to bring the Ark of the Covenant, I know that you're probably somewhat familiar, probably most of you, but let's turn there. 2 Samuel chapter number 6. Let's start reading there at verse number 1. The Bible says, again, David gathered together all the chosen men of Israel, 30,000. David arose and went with all the people who were with him from Baal of Judah to bring up from thence the ark of God, whose name is called by the name of the Lord of hosts, who dwells between the cherubims. For 40 years here it is, the Ark of the Covenant has been in the house of Abinadab. We find that, as there are some folks, and tradition would say, that it's left out in the field and it's uncared for 70 years. Let me tell you, I believe that some churches treat the presence of God like that. It's somewhere out in the field. It's uncared for. It's unnurtured. They don't care about the presence of God. But David said, I want to go and grab hold of the Ark of the Covenant. I want the presence of God. I want it to be cared for. So he makes an attempt to go there. Can I tell you that we must care for the presence of God this morning? It must not be something that is haphazardly handled or thought of, but the presence of God needs to be cared for, not left out in some field. Listen, I know that we have to occupy until Jesus comes, but in the middle of our occupy, the presence of God must also be taken very well care of. So the word of God says, and they set the Ark of the Covenant upon a new cart, and then they brought it out of the house of Abinadab that was in Gibeah. You see, the law of Moses said that the priests must carry the Ark upon their shoulders. And so we are types of priests today. If we are going to care for the presence of God, amen, there's no shortcut to it. We've got to be priests who carry the Ark of the Covenant, the presence of God. The word of God says, and Uzzah and Ahio, the sons of Abinadab, drove the new cart, and they brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was in Gibeah, accompanied the ark of God. And Ahio went up before the ark, and David and all the house of Israel played before the Lord on all manner of instruments, made of fir wood, even harps and psalteries, timbrels and cornets and cymbals. You see, new carts always have to have all kinds of activities to carry them. Let me just share something here. That is why when we come here, I believe it's important for us to sing and to worship. We don't need flags. We don't need dancers. We don't need some new fangaggled music. All we need is to do it God's way.
Amen.
Right? No, there's nothing wrong with technology. There's nothing wrong with songs. But when we try to do it God's, our way instead of God's way, that's when we get in trouble. So here's David. He has all the best intentions. He has a heart after God. But he's going his way. Let's put it on the cart, a new cart. Let's put it on the oxen. The oxen is a symbol of strength. Let's do it on our strength. And you know what? Why don't we add a little bit of music to it? Because music, it makes us all feel better. So David was doing everything, and he was trying to do it right with all the best intentions. But God already had a protocol. God already had a standard. God already had a way of how the ark should be transported. And so here we find that it was that the Bible says that as they're playing and they came to Nathan stretching forth, that Uzzah put forth his hand to take hold of it and it shook. God shook it and man put out his hand and God said, I don't need your hand, man. But you need mine. We try to get our hands in everything and do it our way and get the presence of God our way. Think that we have this little remedy and we have this little recipe that gets it God moving down. God doesn't need our remedy, our recipe. God doesn't need our hand. God has a hand and we don't need to do it on our might or our strength. We just have to do it God's way.
Come on.
Praise God. The Bible says that the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and God smote him there for his error, and he died by the ark of God. You see, I know that Uzzah was trying to give attention to the ark of God, but he should have known better. We can have the best intentions in mind, but if we don't do it God's way, God's way, it angers God. There's a price tag for His presence. There's a cheaper way. But the cheaper way never gives you the quality and never gives you the genuineness of what God has in store for us. The Bible says, and David would not move the ark of the Lord unto the city of David, but David carried to the house of Obadiah to get tight. See, Obadiah started experiencing some good things. The Bible says, and the ark continued in the house of Obadiah to get tight 3 months, and the Lord blessed Obadiah and all of his house. Let's stop here for a minute. I know that this is painful for every one of us. But we see revival happening. But someone died before there was new life and revival. We all want revival. We want the new. We want the blessings of God. We want the power of God. But I need to tell you that if we have real revival, there are things that die in our life. A life of self. A life of the flesh. A life of sin. That all those things have to die before we can ever experience the revival and the greatness of the presence of God. I'm always interested in Isaiah chapter number 6 when Isaiah said, I saw in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and lifted up and his train filled the temple. There are goodbye to things in our life. There are habits and there are things of the flesh that must die in our life. And yes, death is a painful thing. I don't care. You lose an animal, it's still painful for you. It's a pet that's been in your home. And you lose a family member, the magnitude of that. I don't care if grandma's 108 years old. You still miss her and love her because she's part of your family. Death hurts. But the price tag is to know that when we die to ourselves, but the power of the cross and the power of God begins to work in our life, there's newness and there's revival. Oh, God, help us to know that there's a price tag that is paid for the presence of God. If every one of you in the sanctuary would look at your life and when God began to work and move in a powerful way where you saw, it's probably in some of the most difficult times of your life. So thank God for the difficulties. Some of you, if you look and see where your lives had begun to experience the presence and the power of God, you see that it was in moments of prayer where you begin to lay things aside and you said, less of me, but more of you. And that's where the power of God's presence began to be magnified in your life. There is a price tag to the presence of God. And if every one of us in here want the presence of God, we got to be willing to pay the price. The Bible says in verse number 12 that David said, listen, I casually handled the things of God. And I didn't do it God's way. I did it my way. So he said, I need to do this thing right. There's blessings that is falling because of the presence of God. So the Bible says, and so it was told King David, saying, the Lord hath blessed the house of Obed-Edom and all that pertaineth unto him because the ark of God. So David went and brought up the ark of God of the house of Obed-Edom into the city of David with gladness. And it was so that when they that bare the ark of the Lord had gone 6 paces, he sacrificed oxen and fatling, and David danced before the Lord with all his might. And David was girded with a linen ephod. And David and all the house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouting and with the sound of trumpet. And as the Lord came into the city of David, Michael Saul's daughter looked through the window and saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, and she despised him in her heart. And they brought the ark of the Lord and set it in place in the midst of the tabernacle that David had pitched for it. And David offered burnt offerings and peace offerings before the Lord. You see, here it was that David wanted the blessing that was in Obed-Edom's house. So he said, I am going to pay the price and I'm going to do it God's way. And so here they march, and every 15, they stop and they sacrifice an ox. They said, it's no longer with our own strength, but we will say, can you imagine 15 miles? And every 15 paces stopping there and sacrificing? Oh, it's not like the oxen carrying it. There's men carrying it. We're stopping. We're sacrificing. David said, but I'll pay the price for the presence of God. Listen, the journey to having God's presence in my life is not a quick, instant gratification. But it is a process of doing it God's way and saying, I'm sacrificing the strength of myself and I'm doing it your way, God.
and relying upon you.
David said, can you imagine when they get back? You know, I'll be honest. I still like dressing up for church on Sunday. This is how we do it. We like putting on our Sunday best to come to church. It's just the way it is, Sister Tina. It's part of who I am and the belief system that I have. But I have to tell you, I don't believe Brother Craig David looked like I do this morning when he got Brother Dennis to the gates of the city. I believe Brother Wally, there was sweat running down his brow. I believe he was probably bloody from sacrifice. I believe he probably looked pretty rough because he's worked hard, Sister Susan. See, there comes a place in our life where to have the presence of God, we have to lay aside our dignity and say, I'd rather not have my dignity, but I'd rather have the deity of God.
Amen.
See, the presence of God means that we might have to wrestle around with Him in prayer. We might have to sweat. It means like we might have to do a little dancing on the floor. Who cares what our hair looks like? Who cares if our clothes are all tucked in? Who cares? I want the presence of God.
Amen.
And I'll pay the price for it. Here it was that the worshipers came around the veil, around the ark, and there was no veil. Because they were able to experience the presence of God. I'm wrapping up for you to be obeyed. God spoke to Ezekiel and He said, I sought for a man among them that would make up the hedge and stand in the gap for me before the land that I should not destroy it. Listen, God wants all men to be saved. But it takes men and women who are willing to pay the price for the presence of God that others may be saved. This morning I want to ask you a question. Are you willing to pay the price for the presence of God? Are you willing to pay the price? David had all the right intentions, Sister Tina, but he didn't do it God's way. Just getting into the Word of God. And God, I want to live my life your way, that I can have the presence of God. God, I want to do it your way. I want my life's journey to lead me to the place where I honor you. And no matter how long it takes me, no matter how much the work and the sweat, I'll pay the price. The Bible says that Michael, David's wife, looked and despised David in her heart because of his dancing. Oh, you know what happened, Brother Wally? The Bible says that God cursed her womb and closed it up, and she was not able to have children. Who cares what other people say about us or think about us, but we are willing to pay the price for the presence of God. That's why I live holy. That's why I pray. That's why I'll be faithful to every area of God's holiness in my life. I'm not doing it my way. I'm not doing it man's way. But God, I'm doing it your way. I started off the service by saying this. David says, for a day in thy courts is better than a thousand. And I had rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of the wicked. So maybe we'll say, David, if you're a king, why would you want to be a doorkeeper in the house of God? Because being a doorkeeper in the house of God had more influence for the kingdom of God than being the king of the kingdom. I'm not saying let's work for the Saville being the doorkeeper. Yes. Yes, it's work. But I'd rather work and be the doorkeeper in the presence of God than anyone else in life. This morning, are you willing to pay the price for the presence of God? You don't need the internet to read consumer reports. All you need to do is read the Word of God. It gives us the most accurate report of being a consumer of the presence of God. Anything less than God's word and God's standard is less than a 5-star. Don't be a consumer of it. Don't purchase it. Don't waste your time. But God's 5-star rating is. But they that wait upon me shall renew their strength. He that loses his life for me will find it. Take up your cross and follow after me. For me to live is